Macmillan Audio presents How Stella Saved the Farm, a tale about making innovation happen by Vijay Govindarajan and Chris Trimble. Read by Ari Fliakos. Preface. The power of the fable as a teaching tool has been proven throughout the ages. If you grew up in the Western world, for example, you probably remember well the childhood lessons of Aesop's fables, such as The Tortoise and the Hare and The Boy Who Cried Wolf. Fables can be as powerful for adults as they are for young people. In fact, two such fables helped inspire this book. George Orwell's classic Animal Farm illuminated the hidden dangers of communism, and John Cotter's fable Our Iceberg is Melting embedded principles for change management within a delightful tale about a colony of penguins. We have used How Stella Saved the Farm with audiences ranging from senior executives to frontline employees to graduate students. We have seen that storytelling works. It catalyzes the learning process. It cuts through complexities and details, and it invites lively, insightful discussion. We have found that we are able to cover more ground in 3 hours with an audience that has read Stella than in a full day with an audience that has not. How Stella Saved the Farm is grounded in over a decade of research. The story is a composite of dozens of innovation initiatives we have observed in established organizations. In pilot programs with early readers, several participants told us they thought the book must have been based on their own companies. That's how we knew Stella was doing its job. Our intent in this book is to focus on a handful of the most fundamental principles for managing an innovation initiative, not to thoroughly examine the subject. For readers looking for a more complete and traditional treatment, we suggest The Other Side of Innovation, Solving the Execution Challenge, Harvard Business Review Press, 2010. That book is based on the same research as this book, but it offers in-depth recommendations, comprehensive analysis, and numerous real-world examples of innovation inside recognizable companies like IBM, BMW, and Deere & Company. But honestly, you'll get more out of The Other Side if you read Stella first. You'll just need to be able to withstand the fun of a narrative that is lighthearted in tone despite its serious intent. Prologue. The airline announced the final boarding call, and Stella gave Alejandro one last hug. She leaned into his strong body and nuzzled his long neck. Finally, she turned and walked toward the gate. How had this happened? Stella had hoped to fall in love someday, but she hardly expected it to happen so soon. Stella had high aspirations, and she didn't regard getting swept off her feet as an aspiration at all. Only a few months earlier, she had graduated from school with the firm expectation that she would change the world. Of course, she wasn't sure exactly how she would change the world, but she was eager to get going. Working for her family's substantial farming operation, gaining real-world experience, and building skills for the future. Stella's mother, hardly a type A like Stella, had offered some parental advice. "You have the rest of your life to work," she told her daughter. "And work's not all it's cracked up to be. See the world first. Enjoy yourself." So Stella had postponed her career plans. She had purchased a backpack, a discount airline ticket, and a guidebook. Peru on $10 per day. She was prepared to rough it, with one exception. There was no way she would let go of her BlackBerry. She started her trip in the mountains, hiking the Inca Trail. She made friends with other backpackers from around the world, intoxicated by their unusual backgrounds, interests, and perspectives. One day, she made the difficult ascent to Machu Picchu, the famous Inca ruin. A thick mist had settled over the summit. Stella took a break, resting on a rock. That's when Alejandro appeared through the fog. "Care for a cherry lifesaver?" he offered. Stella looked up, way up, to make eye contact. Alejandro was tall. He was handsome. Like the country of Peru itself, he seemed so exotic. "Sure, have a seat," she invited. For the next few months, they traveled together, Stella discovering a foreign world, Alejandro exploring his own country, each learning about the other. They photograph strange birds in the Amazon. They sun themselves on beaches. They brave the catacombs beneath the centuries-old monastery in Lima. Stella couldn't deny her physical attraction to Alejandro. She admired his rugged, fit form. Yet he also conveyed an air of luxuriousness, even softness. Stella found the combination irresistible. Now, after her whirlwind romance, Stella walked onto the plane in deep thought. Leaving Alejandro was not her only source of anxiety. She checked her BlackBerry again. More bad news from Deirdre, her mentor at Windsor Farm. The economics of the farming operation were steadily deteriorating. Deirdre was under extraordinary pressure. It was time, Stella knew, to head home and try to help. She squirmed in her seat, unable to get comfortable. Airplane seats just weren't designed for bodies like hers. You see, Stella was a sheep. Alejandro was an alpaca. And this, indeed, is a fable. Will Stella save the farm? The title of the book says she does. Doesn't necessarily make it so. Part 1. Chapter 1. 3 months earlier. Deirdre settled in behind her large mahogany desk, custom made for a horse. Two new emails appeared on her computer screen. She first read the one from her broker, reminding her to lock in a price for fall corn. She made a mental note of it. Deirdre had been managing Windsor Farm's corn and soybean crops for about a year, and she enjoyed the challenge. The other email, from her young protege, Stella, described the magic of the Inca Trail. Stella wrote so descriptively about her adventures that Deirdre could almost imagine herself in Peru. Still, Deirdre thought, it would be nice to have Stella back at Windsor. She was the most unsheepish sheep Deirdre had ever encountered, a born leader. Hooves sounded outside her office. Deirdre's father, Marcus, filled the doorframe. He looked powerful as always, though unusually tired. Marcus had run the farm for over 2 decades, modernizing the operation and nearly quadrupling its size. Experienced, knowledgeable, and wise, he was respected both on and off the farm.
"How are my grandsons?" Marcus began with his usual greeting. "Keeping up with their studies?"
Deirdre smiled, thinking about her energetic colts, Russell and Thomas. "They're keeping up just fine," she answered. "I'm the one who has trouble keeping up with them." But Marcus obviously had something else on his mind.
"Deirdre, there comes a time in every stallion's life when it becomes necessary to confront retirement. I've come to that point. I am ready."
What? Of course everyone on the farm knew Marcus would have to retire at some point, but it was an eventuality Deirdre preferred to keep at a distance.
"Dad, of course, everyone in our farm family will support your choice. You've certainly earned a nice retirement, but why now? You seem as on top of your game as ever."
Marcus ran a remarkably tight and efficient business. He inspired operational excellence throughout the farm. Deirdre smiled, thinking about how Windsor's managers were almost obsessed with finding opportunities to improve performance.
"I'm not doing the farm any favors by continuing as its leader," said Marcus. "I've done what I can. I have but one more responsibility, to make sure the farm is in good hands for the future."
"Dad, have you told Bull yet?"
Deirdre could just picture enormous Bull bucking for joy at the news.
Bull was Windsor's second in command. He headed Bovine Ops, the farm's dairy business, and ran it like a finely tuned milking machine. He was strong, dominant, and so bullheaded that everyone used his obvious nickname, Bull, rather than his given name, Harold.
"Deirdre, we need to talk." Marcus lowered his voice. "I no longer believe Bull is the right choice to succeed me."
Deirdre was stunned.
"But Bull has been your number two for years, always right by your side."
"That's exactly the problem. Bull will run the business exactly as I do. That's not what this farm needs. Every day it becomes more obvious that efficiency is no longer enough, at least if we want to keep this a family-run company."
Deirdre needed a moment to think. She glanced out her window to the pastures beyond. The day was spectacularly sunny. The sheep grazed peacefully in the distance. Decades ago, when animals had first started running their own farms,
they had quickly demonstrated an intuitive grasp of agriculture. Humans, however, had been quicker to put machines to work. Marcus had taken a few steps in that direction, acquiring two prized tractors he kept in top shape. He sometimes referred to the tractors as the real workhorses at Windsor, though that remark hadn't gone over too well with some of the touchier team members. Could things really be as bad as her father was suggesting? Marcus interrupted Deirdre's musings.
Human-run farms just keep consolidating and using ever more sophisticated machines. You know their motto, bigger is cheaper. If we don't do something soon, the notion of an animal-run farm could become as outdated as the horse-drawn plow.
Deirdre had never seen her father so agitated.
Our farm has grown, Marcus continued, but it is still small by comparison. We can try to play the size game, but family first has always been our most cherished principle.
As it should be, Dad, agreed his daughter. Marcus looked spent, his forelock uncharacteristically disheveled beneath his hat.
I'm going to tell you something in complete confidence, Deirdre. I keep getting calls from people who want to buy our farm. McGillicuddy has mentioned the possibility at least 3 times.
Deirdre felt the hair along her braided mane stand up. The competition between animal-run and human-run farms was ever-present. For the most part, it was a rivalry of mutual respect. But McGillicuddy, a human who ran the giant operation adjacent to Windsor Farm, had never accepted the modern reality of animals running their own farms. He also was notorious for his poor treatment of working animals.
I'm worried, Marcus said. Someday we may have no choice but to sell. It's happened to some of our friends.
But you run a much better farm.
It could happen to us!
Marcus cut off his daughter's protest. There was no time to sugarcoat the situation.
We need a new kind of leader. Someone creative, someone courageous, someone capable of taking the farm in new directions.
He looked his daughter in the eye.
Ever since you were young, you've shown that you have a different kind of mind. You have always been one to see beyond the obvious, to spot the unusual solution.
Deirdre swallowed hard. Was this going where she thought it was?
I want you to take on the responsibility of running the farm, Marcus said.
Deirdre thought of the small team she currently managed, how far they had come, how proud she was of them. But was she ready to take responsibility for overseeing the entire farm?
Dad, I've just started running my own division. The job of leading the farm calls for someone more experienced, more ambitious.
Deirdre, you're Windsor's best hope for enduring success. And let me make one thing very clear. I'm not giving you the job because you are my daughter. You almost certainly would have run the farm after Bull anyway. I'm giving you the job because you are the right horse at the right time.
Deirdre studied her favorite photograph of Russell and Thomas, with Russell looking straight at the camera with a big horsey grin, and Thomas engaged in watching something just off camera. Was their future on Windsor Farm really in jeopardy? Next to the photo of her boys was one of her late mother, who had always told her she was destined to do great things. Beside that was a picture of her beloved late husband, who had been killed in a tractor accident just 1 week after she had given birth to the colts.
So, will you accept the job?
Deirdre met her father's tired, kind gaze. She thought about how much time and energy he had devoted to helping her raise Russell and Thomas. She knew there was one thing she could not do, one word she could not utter. She couldn't possibly say no. Will Marcus save the farm? Will Deirdre save the farm? Chapter 2. Marcus spent the following week meeting discreetly with Deirdre to help her prepare to take over. Now it was time to break the news to Bull. Marcus called Deirdre and Bull into his office. As he walked in, Bull noticed the portrait of Marcus hanging on the wall.
Someday, he thought, it will be my portrait in that spot.
After exchanging pleasantries, Marcus explained quickly and directly what was about to happen. Bull sat in stunned silence for a moment, then lowered his head and charged out of the office.
Let him run off some steam, Marcus said to Deirdre.
An hour later, Deirdre found Bull in the sheep pasture bristling, shaking his head angrily and pawing the ground with his forehooves, sending the dirt flying behind him. His ill temper frightened the sheep, and their frantic bleats filled the air. Some had managed to climb into a tree, One poor ewe was hanging from a branch, scared to death even though she was, at most, 2 feet off the ground. Bull caught sight of Deirdre and snorted. Deirdre approached him cautiously and invited him to sit beside her in the shade. She knew that somehow she needed to win him over. Reluctantly, Bull trotted over, all 2,800 pounds of him. All the sheep except the one dangling from the tree took the opportunity to run for the hills.
"You were expecting to be the next leader of the farm," said Deirdre gently.
"Everyone was expecting I would be next."
"Including me," said Deirdre. "Can I ask what were your plans for the farm?"
"You know my motto. Faster, stronger, more efficient."
Bull had posted it over his desk.
"We're a well-run farm, but we could be better," he said. "I have lots of ideas for improvement. I'm ready for more responsibility."
"You are indeed, Bull. You are indeed." Bull sighed.
"I love this farm, Deirdre, but there are other farms that need good leadership."
Deirdre had anticipated this response. She knew the depth of Bull's pride.
"This farm needs your leadership. This farm has your leadership," he countered.
"Bull, think for just a moment what would happen in your absence. You know every aspect of this farm like the back of your hoof. The other animals look up to you."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.